anointing is empowering. The kingdom of the Lord is within me.
Welcome to the prophetic teaching and healing ministry of Pastor Olufemi Fadeyi, the senior pastor of Divine Glory Christian Church. We bring you this faith and power-filled, life-transforming word of God. For the scripture says, the entrance of his word gives light and understanding to the simple. Get ready for the miraculous and be blessed.
Somebody shout hallelujah. God bless us all. Let's take our seats in the Holy Ghost. Glory be to God. You know, it's lovely praising God. I don't know who I'm speaking to this morning. Your reason for praising God will always multiply. Come on, tell somebody how we praise him every day. He's the love of my life. I will celebrate him forever. The Lord said there's somebody here. He said, I should tell you, you will not harvest calamity. That is to say, no matter what is going on there in the employment world, it will not reach you. No matter what is going on there in the unemployment world, it will not reach you. No matter what is going on there, outside there, and I mean in terms of adoption, in terms of any form of criminality, robbery, or whatever it can be called, by the power of the Holy Ghost, it will never be close to you. Theft will never come close to your house. By the power of the Holy Ghost, every form of sadness, any form of satanic atrocity will never be proximate to your habitation. Because you are the one receiving this blessing, let your human shake your neighbors off the seat. Glory be to God in the highest. I am going to be blessed today. Jesus Christ is already here. The Holy Ghost. How many people are going to be blessed? If you're going to be blessed today, sing the song. I'm going to be blessed today. I am going to be blessed. Jesus Christ is already here. The Holy Ghost is already. Father, we give you the praise. Thank you for utterance. Amen. Glory be to God. The Lord has been taking us on a series, which was started 2 Sundays ago, titled The Ultimate of the Christian Race. The Ultimate of the Christian Race. And God made us to understand that a Christian race ultimately is not supposed to culminate in you just entering heaven, as it were. Because if heaven is everything that God has in mind for you, I think the day you gave your life to Christ could have taken you home. Am I talking to somebody here? But God wants you to reproduce Christ in your life. Am I talking to somebody here? He wants the fullness of Jesus in terms of his nature and in terms of his power to be reproduced in your life. There is somebody here. You will walk over circumstances of life. There is nothing in life again that will dominate you. Sickness will not dominate you. It will not dominate your family. Poverty will not dominate you. I am praying for you. I say lack will never dominate you. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? Jesus lived a life above it. Even when there was no physical cash on him, he would tell them, come, there is a fish there. That is my ATM machine for the hour. Am I talking to somebody here? And several women followed him and ministered to him of their substance. Luke chapter 8 from verse 1. Please listen, ladies and gentlemen. Everybody ministered to Jesus. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible says, as he is, so are you in this world. Wherever you find yourself, favor is on you. This week, it will be clear to every devil that favor is answering for you. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Glory be to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So the reproduction of Jesus in our life is the ultimate purpose of God for us. That is the central purpose of God for every believer. The Bible said in Romans chapter number 8, and starting from verse number 28, Romans chapter 8, starting from verse 28 down to verse 29, the Bible says, and these we know all things work together for good, for those that love God, that are called according to his purpose. And these we know all things work together for good. Glory be to God. for those that love God that are called according to his purpose. For those he did foreknow, he did predestinate, that they be conformed to the image of his son, that he may be the firstborn among many brethren. For those he did foreknow, the Bible says he did predestinate that they be conformed to the image of his son. And listen, ladies and gentlemen, we all know that this is the central purpose of God. The Bible says those who are called according to his purpose. Yes, what is that purpose? For those he did foreknow. They are the ones that he did predestinate that they be conformed to the image of his son. So the central purpose of God for your life is conformity with the image of Jesus. That when they look at you, all they can see is Jesus, the likeness of Christ. God told us all of these in the first part of this message. And ladies and gentlemen, Jesus' image only takes us into the image of God. I think we all know that. Genesis chapter 1 verse 26, the Bible says, let us make man our own image and likeness. That is God speaking. So if I can conform to the image of Jesus, I conform to the image of God, which is the original purpose of God for my creation. And Jesus, we all know, is the image of God. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3, the Bible says Jesus is the express image of his person. Jesus is the express image of God. So when I conform to the image of Jesus, I conform to the image of God, which takes me straight into Genesis 1:26, the original purpose for my creation, the law of first mention. God said that is all I wanted to be. If you can be that way, God said he will have dominion over the fish of the sea. He will have dominion over the fowls of the air. He will have dominion over the cattle and over all the earth and over all the creeping things that creepeth upon the surface of the earth. God is saying your dominion in life will be absolute if you can conform to my image. That is to say, if you can know more about my nature and you can know more about my power. So we've been exploring the image of Jesus, exploring the life of Jesus, because all that God ever expects from you and I, Jesus had come to demonstrate. There is nothing God expects from you that Jesus had not demonstrated. Please listen, ladies and gentlemen. He is the fullness of the Father's expectation from any believer. Jesus is the fullness. There is nothing else that God is expecting from me that we never saw in Jesus. So therefore, it is very important that we study this Jesus. And I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, as we are studying him, miracles will be happening in your life. Transformations will be happening in your life. T.L. Osborne, how did he start his great ministry? T.L. Osborne told his wife, he said, see, we want to see Jesus. So the two of them started exploring Jesus. They started studying and they started praying. Jesus, we want to see you. We just want to know you. Suddenly one day, he was almost getting out and Jesus appeared to him. From that day, his ministry never remained the same again. Do you know what I'm talking about? And he began to see revelations from God's word. I don't know who I'm speaking to here. You will see Jesus. I said, you will see Jesus. Something is ultimately changing about your life. Something is ultimately changing about your family. You will see Jesus. Lift up your two and say, I see Jesus. Glory be to God. So ladies and gentlemen, the revelation of Jesus is all God expects from us. In Ephesians chapter number 5 and verse 25. Ephesians chapter number 5 and verse 25. The Bible says, husband, love your wife as Christ has loved the church. And has given himself even for heat, that he may wash her by the washing of water by the word, that he may present unto himself a glorious church, not without wrinkles, nor spot or blemish or anything, but must be holy. And of course, the Bible says must be without any form of blemish. Now, the Bible said here that Jesus presents unto himself a glorious church that is not without any apparel. It is not without any reproach. Please understand that the church of Christ is not without contempt. If there is any reproach in your life today, it is rolled away. The Bible said in Luke chapter 1, that's Elizabeth said, "Thus the Lord has dealt with me. He has looked down upon me and he has removed my reproach from among men." And God said concerning the Israelites, he said, "Today I've rolled the reproach of Egypt away from you." Please understand, Jesus does not want a church with reproach. So I'm telling somebody here, not a single reproach shall be left in your life. You call it sinful reproach, it will not be there. You call it any form of reproach in your health, in your finance, it will not be left there. Am I talking to somebody here? He presents unto himself a perfect church. Come on, tell somebody, a perfect church. That means when you look at them, there is no way you can reproach them. Ah, Omo, we are irreproachable. Tell somebody, I'm irreproachable. And the attainment of this status, ladies and gentlemen, is through the instrumentality of the word. The Bible said that he may wash her body, washing of water by the word. Am I talking to somebody here? So as the word of God is being preached on Jesus, God is cleansing somebody. God is removing reproach from somebody. I mean, God is purifying and purging somebody. Oh, come on. Am I talking to somebody here? As this word is being preached, something is happening in somebody's life. A transformation is taking place in somebody's life. The word of God is finally finding an ultimate route for a total revolution in your life. So it takes place through the word. Come on, tell somebody, it takes place through the word. So the word of God is all that it takes to remove any reproach. Am I talking to somebody here? So Jesus said, "I'm going to present an irreproachable church unto me," because that is how he is. Remember, the Bible says, "He that knew no sin was made sin for us." So it's not going to take a church with sin. And at the same time, it's not going to take a church that is battered and shattered. It's not going to take a victim as a church. No. My Jesus is victorious. So the church must function in victory to be like him. Glory be to God. Am I talking to somebody here? Tell somebody, I can never be a victim. Oh, somebody's not saying it well. I can never be a victim. Glory be to God. So ladies and gentlemen, this is all that it takes for us to understand the Christian race that God has called us into. A life of holiness. A life of righteousness. A life of prosperity. A life of increase. A life of spiritual soundness and physical soundness. Am I talking to somebody here? God is balanced. You will never in any way in your life be short of that. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? He has called us to a perfect life. Come on, tell somebody, I am perfect. Because he has made me perfect. Glory be to God. So he takes the word to reveal Jesus to us, that he may purify her by the washing of water by the word. So except the word is revealed to you, you don't have an accurate picture of Jesus. And the moment you can have an accurate picture of Jesus, it destroys all the works of darkness concerning your life. Please understand, if the devil is pressing anybody down, it's because you've not seen the accurate image of Jesus. When you see it, you will walk out of that affliction. The Bible says in 1 John chapter number 3 and verse number 8, he said, Lenge hokzu hanahanga, zinamata brodia gabaya, nenko prodi hakdo zinanante hakdi zanahanta haya. For this purpose was the Son of Man made manifest, that he may destroy the works of darkness. Now, you know what he's talking about there? Just make Jesus manifest. Paint the correct picture of the image of Jesus. Let him be manifest for people to see that this is how he lived his life. This is who he is. This is what he achieved for you. Please understand, if you can make him manifest, it destroys the work of darkness. Tell me, he on himself took away my infirmities. He destroyed sickness in my body. Am I talking to somebody here? Tell me that he had paid the price for my prosperity. He was crucified nakedly, which represents the highest level of poverty. And then, ladies and gentlemen, I know what it takes to walk free out of poverty. Am I talking to somebody here? Make him manifest, people will rejoice. I don't know who I'm talking to here, you will rejoice. This week is your week of rejoicing. Lift up your two and say, I receive it. Glory be to God. So we begin to look at several aspects of the life of Jesus as it relates to our lives. And at the same time, as we consider these aspects of the life of Jesus, we begin to see how it relates to us and what we can bring out of it and apply to our present lives. Because God wants us to function in the nature and power of God with Jesus as showcased unto us. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. So today, by God's grace, we go on studying his life. The last time, God made us to understand that there are several aspects of his life. Of course, I mean, Jesus had a social life. Jesus had a spiritual life. Jesus had a good financial life, maybe academic life as well, you know, a studious life and all that. There are several aspects of his life. And we started from the spiritual life of Jesus. The spiritual life of Jesus. So let us look at the spiritual life of this Jesus. Because if all God is expecting from me is to reproduce this Christ in my life, then I got to know how his spiritual life was. And then I got to know how to take in these things into my life, add it to my life. And then the more I had it, the more I'm like him. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And then we started looking at his spiritual life from his prayer life. Am I right? From where? Okay. So we're still going on his prayer life. You see, Jesus prayed all through the scriptures. You know, basically we could see all of that. And one thing I want us to understand is that, you see, these points are scattered everywhere. We just pick them here and there, here and there, here and there. And then we put them together and we are able to see some things we can add to our prayer life. Do you understand what I'm talking about? You know, from his prayer life. So I believe that we still have some points to bring out of his prayer life, which will still be somebody's blessing today. Amen. Glory be to God. So today, by the grace of God, we go on his prayer life. Now, I want to let you know this, that these points are not exhaustive about his prayer life, but at least they help us to gain further advancement in our journey in Christianity. By the time you do your own personal studies, you still discover more about the Holy Ghost. Am I talking to somebody here? This message is one of the greatest messages every Christian needs. I'm telling you. This is all that God expects from you. Study it and let it propel a greater study in your own life as well. Let it take you into your closet and begin to study more about this Jesus. And ladies and gentlemen, the more you study, the more the glory that redounds on you. See, as Moses sat down and was beholding the word of God, God gave him the Ten Commandments, and he was just meditating for 40 days, just communicating with God and looking at the word. The Bible says his face was shining. And the Bible says we also are taken from one glory to the other. Do you understand? As we behold that image and see that image, the Bible said it's through the word that we can see it. As we behold that image, the same glory begins to redound in our lives. So if you want your life to be more glorious, pay attention to this. Because we are beholding his image now. We are looking at him now. Am I talking to somebody here? Tell somebody, I see Jesus. Glory be to God. The last time we were able to look at his prayer life and some of the points we saw was that it provoked the supernatural in prayers. And then we were able to look at the frequency of his prayers, that he prayed very often. The Bible says he often withdrew into the wilderness to pray. And at the same time, we also looked at the fact that Jesus had a private prayer life, closet life and all that. You know, quiet time and, you know, all those basic things. They had some aloneness with God. Glory be to God. Am I talking to somebody here? So today we move on this series. And next thing I want to let us see is that Jesus lived a balanced ministerial life through prayers. That's the next point, point four. Now, he lived a balanced life through prayers. Maybe I shouldn't use the word ministerial. Let me just say a balanced assignment. He carried out his assignment on a balanced platform through prayers. Jesus executed his assignment on a balanced platform through prayers. And if you say he lived a balanced ministerial life through prayers, you are still on point. Am I talking to somebody here? We are talking about the same thing. Now hear this, ladies and gentlemen. Jesus was a man that had several aspects to his assignments. The Bible made us to understand that when he came, he told his disciples, and most especially in the case of the Syrophoenician woman, in Matthew chapter number 15, Lembronia, the Lord said there is somebody here. He said, I should tell you, that thing that is banging your head today, God is removing it finally. From now on, that head will never bang you anymore. And then the Lord said, there's someone here. He said, I'm breaking you free completely from that emotional attachment, which you're not supposed to have. God said, you are free in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit of God. There was a time God gave me this word for someone, and I was preaching. I just gave the word. And a guy was struggling with his marriage with a lady. Suddenly, as I gave the word, the guy received the word. The same, you know, Satan is wicked. When the word comes, he goes for the word. Just like few seconds after, like that, about a minute after, the lady pinged the guy straight. How are you? Are you still thinking about me? Are you? The guy said, no, I'm sorry. I am free. The guy came to the office to share testimony. He said, from that day, I became free. I don't know who I'm speaking to here. You are free. Every negative attachment, you are free from it forever. Glory be to God. So Jesus fulfilled his assignment and all the aspects of his assignment on a balanced platform. You see, ladies and gentlemen, he had several aspects to his assignment. The Bible made us to understand something very strategic about him. That in Matthew chapter 15, in the case of the Syrophoenician woman, Jesus told the woman, verse 24, Matthew 15, he said, I am sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. I'm not sent to any other person. The jurisdiction of my assignment is limited to this, to the nation of Israel. But the nation of Israel has several cities. The nation of Israel has several towns. The nation of Israel has several villages. Am I talking to somebody here? And Jesus had to touch on all these villages one after the other. He had to go to Nazareth, the village where he grew up. He had to go to Galilee and all the cities of King Galilee, all the towns. He had to go to this Samaria. He had to go to that. He had to go to Judea, all over. You know, he had to minister everywhere. And Jesus knew that he only had 3 years to do this. He's like saying you have to go run all the areas in Lagos within 3 years and minister. And you know that you need to finish everything before you can say it is finished. Am I talking to somebody here? I mean, ladies and gentlemen, you will know that at times we have several sets of assignments in front of us. We will do some well. Some will say there was no time. There was no... Listen, ladies and gentlemen, you also had time. When the time for darkness came, Jesus said, the time of darkness has come. You understand what I'm talking about? And the power of hell. The time for them had come. He knew that, see, he only had a short time to do the work. He said, I must do the work of him that sent me while this day, for the night cometh when no man can walk again. He knew that he had the time allotted for him, and he knew he had this whole bulk of assignment in front of him. Ladies and gentlemen, we always find ourselves in this kind of situation. At times we have multiple callings and we have multiple giftings. And at times we don't know even how to relate and balance all these multiple callings and giftings. We don't know. At times we just, you know, allow some to drop down. I mean, to just lie down there. And at times just take up some. You work on some and you leave others. You abandon others. And God is saying that, look, during your lifetime, I want you to explore all these things. There are multi-talented people listening to me. You can do several things than what you're doing. But you see, the issue is that we'll say that this one alone is taking 26 hours a day from me. Where would I have the time for others? Don't we find ourselves in this kind of situation? Family men, am I right? Yeah, you are a husband. To be a husband alone can take 25 hours a day. Am I talking to somebody here? Men in the house, am I talking? Okay. you are a father, am I right? Your children are there, they need your attention. At the same time, you are the breadwinner, you got to work, you got to bring money home. And then there are things in the house to fix. And at the same time, your extended family needs you. And in your place of work, there are assignments and there are these and there are that given to you. And you have all these things to work on. Everything within 24 hours. You don't have more than that. Ladies and gentlemen, there are women here, oh my goodness, they have their hands full. You must be a successful wife. And at the same time, you must be a good mother. Your children need you. You find yourself also having to work to support the family. And at the same time, you even have several fields of talents even given unto you, men and women. We have all these things in our lives. You can be working in a bank today and God is saying, look, my son, I still want you also to open up that tailoring outfit. I wanted to be a fashion designer as well. You just know that the passion for it is in your heart. You know that you have the gifting. Or you know that, yeah, you're working in a school and at the same time you can also cater. You know? You know that, see, hospitality and this and that, you know, is part of the gifting you have. You know all these things that, look, you are multi-talented in several things. See, every talent God gave you, he wants you to explore them. Do you understand what I'm talking about? But the situation in Lagos in itself does not allow some situations, things to happen. By the time you desire to go and fulfill your work alone, the traffic will take about 3 hours or 4 hours from you in a day. If the number of hours traffic is taken from people is converted into useful productivity. Ladies and gentlemen, I think a lot of people must have had some transformations in their lives. Am I talking to people here? But listen, ladies and gentlemen, we have all these things contending just for the time you have. Everything is saying, I want to take my home portion. And God is still expecting you to finish your assignment. How do I touch on all these aspects? Listen, ladies and gentlemen, it seems to be like a kind of mogul's assignment that God has given unto us. How do I explore all my calling? I was studying about life of Brother Paul, and God was speaking to me. I was just meditating on it. And Brother Paul was speaking in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 11. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 11. He said, see, I've been appointed a preacher and an apostle and at the same time a teacher of the Gentiles. Now the word preacher there means an evangelist, because he was going preaching the gospel. Jesus says, you go preach the gospel. Are you catching what I'm talking about? He was to go to the Gentiles and evangelize them, and at the same time now disciple them. Like he had the school of Tyrannus and all that, where he was discipling them. And then he must teach them the principles of God. He was a teacher to the entire body of Christ. See his writings. We are all drinking from it today. Am I talking to somebody here? This man had all these different aspects of calling on his life. And he must fulfill all those. If you're only evangelizing and you don't have time to disciple people, you are not yet an apostle. Because that's the work of an apostle. Do you understand? If you are only discipling and you are not teaching people or teaching the body, writing the letters which he wrote, please listen, ladies and gentlemen, he is not yet fulfilled his assignment. Imagine Paul never wrote any of these letters and he died just like any other apostle. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? What will our generation live on? What would we have as scriptures today? Am I talking to somebody here? All these things are the things God called him to do from the beginning of his life. Friends, you will fulfill your assignment. It doesn't matter how busy the world is getting. I said somebody here will fulfill his assignment. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? We have these different aspects of our lives, everything contending for the same time and resource that we have. But listen, ladies and gentlemen, there is a way to have it balanced and to have it fulfilled. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter number 5 and verse number 8, it said, be sober and be vigilant. For your enemy, the adversary, that is going about looking for someone to devour. The Lord said, there is someone here. He said, he's repeating it again. You've heard the news that something is to happen this week. And I perceive so strongly that it's like this thing is around your place of work. The Lord said, that calamity will not be close to you. Yeah. You see, it can sweep off many people, but you will never be engulfed by the calamity. Yeah. And because you believe what I'm talking about, let your amen be louder. Yeah. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? So listen, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, the Bible says, be sober and be vigilant. I love how the Amplified Bible puts it. He said, be balanced. That is it. That is to say, every aspect of your life, God wants it to be balanced. A false balance, Proverbs 11:1, the Bible says, is an abomination before the Lord. If you don't have a proper balance in your life, the Bible says God hates it. So if you are giving too much attention to your children while you are neglecting your husband, the Bible says God hates it. It's an abomination. And if you are a good wife and a poor mother, the Bible says it's an abomination as well. And if you are so good ministerially and you don't raise your children, the Bible says it's an abomination. Samuel was so good ministerially and his two children started collecting bribes. The problem of Israel, while they asked for king, was Samuel, because he did not raise his children. He was busy going from city to one city to the other at the expense of raising his children. Please understand, the Bible says God looks for a godly seed. Come on, be balanced. Tell somebody, be balanced. On every side, God wants you to be balanced. As a father, be balanced. Combine it with your ministerial work. Combine it with your assignment. Combine it with everything and make sure that everything is going well. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, Jesus was the first man that demonstrated it. He was balanced on every side. The Bible said in Luke that Jesus grew. He increased, verse 40, in wisdom. He increased, verse 40, the Bible says, and he grew in stature. Is that Luke 1 or Luke 2? I think that should be Luke 1, right? Luke 1, verse 40. He increased in stature. He waxed strong in the spirit. Verse 52, the Bible says, and he increased in wisdom. That means spirit, soul, and body, he was balanced. Wisdom relates to the soul. Spirit is spirit. In stature, his body, he was balanced in his growth. And when he was balanced as well ministerially, everything he needed to do, he caught it from prayers. I told you in Mark chapter 1 verse 35, you can remember the last time I was preaching, that Jesus finished ministering, he healed the whole city, and the next morning they were looking for him. Jesus had gone to pray in a private place, Mark 1:35, and when they came looking for him, when they finally found him, Jesus said, we must go over to the next city. They said, everybody's looking for you. Where are they looking for you? For Thanksgiving now, everybody has come to come and rejoice for the healing they got yesterday night. The blind is coming with envy. The lame, the rich man that was healed of cancer, every one of them came. Do you understand what I'm talking about? With their Thanksgiving offerings and all that. And Jesus said, no. In the place of prayer this morning, from the information made available to me, I must move over to the other towns. You see, supposing he spent one day there, one extra day, it would have affected other towns. He said, let us go over, verse 38, Mark 1, to other towns. Am I talking to somebody here? He knew the time to move to other places. So his time allotment was accurate and was sufficient to finish his assignment. As at the time he was on the cross, Jesus said, it is finished. I touch on every aspect. There was nothing expected of me that I didn't do. Even as a son, he took care of his father. He was on the cross and he was looking at his mother like this. And he said, son, look at your mother. Mother, look at... Now, remember, the Bible said Jesus had brothers and sisters. He did not commit the welfare of his mother, even to his own brother. He committed it to... That means, in relationship, a disciple is higher than a brother. The love in Christianity is... Jesus na perfect man, Omo. I'm not talking to somebody here. He had brothers and sisters and did not commit the welfare of his mother to them. The Bible said, from that day, that guy hijacked the mother of James and the rest, and Joseph, and carried the mother to his own house. From that day. So he was so perfect that he was taking care of his mother. He was ministering to the people. He was doing everything. Jesus, not perfect man. He was balanced. It was in the place of prayer he knew how to allot resources to every aspect. So I'm telling somebody here, when you pray very accurately, you will be shocked that the time you always say it's not sufficient is sufficient. The time you say it's not sufficient is what? Because God will give you extra energy to cope with many things. I remember when I was a student, some of my classmates were here. I was ministering, I was doing everything. You know what they said in my hall? Pastor Eben, you know, he has ministered here severally. You know what he said? He was the pastor of the largest fellowship then. Handed over to him, Pastor Luis handed over to him. So he said, he was living in my hall. He said, I want to see how this brother will graduate. He's always ministering every day. And that's the truth. Somebody saw me in Chapel of Resurrection. He said, there is no day you don't come here. You are always here ministering. Even on the day of my exams, I was still there ministering. I will have exam by 4 p.m. I will be in chapel till 1 p.m. ministering. And then I'll go. I said, Lord, I only have 3 hours left. Just show me what I need to read. And the funniest part of it, I read those things. I went and I scored 70 something. Am I talking to somebody here? Why? Because extra things will always meet. When I was a student in Harvard, I was always traveling. I mean, a number of us who knew me then knew. I would be in Nigeria. There was one exam. I was in Nigeria. Anytime exam came, that was the best time to travel for me. And I would come without a single book. There was one exam. I left Harvard December 15. Exam was to start January 12. I left Harvard December 15. I came to Nigeria and I booked my return for January 10 to enter Harvard January 11 to start exam the next day. And I did not come with a single book. I ministered everywhere. Nobody knew that I had exam in front of me. When I entered Harvard 8 p.m. Exam the next morning. I said, Father, I've got to do your work everywhere. Have mercy on me. What are the areas I must read? You know, and the Holy Ghost just pointed me to those areas. Pa, 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 pa. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, I read those areas, read overnight, entered the exam hall. My eyes were bloodshot. Entered the exam hall the next day. I just sat down there, did all that I needed to do and all that. When the result came out in distinction. He's, and somebody, God is my witness, students never left Harvard. You need, they will tell you you need 27 hours to, per day to be a good student in Harvard. They didn't go for Christmas, they didn't go for New Year. They were busy reading. Omo, there is a grace. I'm telling somebody, a grace to be balanced, God is giving you right now. That some people will go for studies and they will close their ministry. They will close their shop. They will close their business. They will close all affairs of their life. All because they want to face academic. But listen, you can excel in both. Am I talking to somebody here? You can do what? You can excel. And when I was leaving, who would believe? There was, Mrs. Samuel's cousin is here. There was another exam for me. I left Harvard. Exam was to start. I left Harvard and I came to Nigeria. I entered Harvard the day before the exam again. And I do the same thing. I even went for graduation in Missouri. I came to Nigeria. I was enjoying myself without any book and nobody knew. And when I finished, the dean said, we looked at your result. He said, we never had a single student like you. He said, we have never had in the history of Harvard. That is every record unbroken. I left them broken. That is, and I didn't have the time, but the Holy Spirit, the little I had to read, something amplified it in me. May I pray over somebody here? From today, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, no aspect of your life will die for the other. Every aspect of your life will be working pare passu. And excellence will be coming out of it in the name of Jesus. Your finance is working. I say your health is working. Your family is working. Your jobs is working. Everything about you is working. That is the grace that God is talking about. You can be balanced on every side. Come on, tell somebody, I am balanced on every side. In the name of Jesus. We see Jesus driving that heart of his prayer life. Glory be to God. What else do we see out of the prayer life of Jesus? Ladies and gentlemen, we see his love life in prayers. We see Jesus using prayers to drive his love life and using his love life to drive prayers. We see his love life reflected in prayers. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen, this is one major aspect that I would like everybody here today to please understand. That when your love life is... the Lord said there is somebody here. I can see a mountain and I saw you climbing a mountain. The Lord said you don't need to climb a mountain for that matter. He said, I have done it. Yeah. You don't need to do that fast. God said, I have answered you. Yeah. If you are that person, I think your human should be robustic. Yeah. Glory be to God. Am I talking to somebody here? What was I saying? It's love life in prayers. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen, I saw Jesus using prayers to showcase his love life, and at the same time you could see everything about him being reflected in prayers. As far as his personality of love was concerned, friend, prayer is an instrument to drive your love life. Jesus showed us. If you are having issues with love, pray. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen. Today we have seen a direct opposite of the doctrinal injunctions of Jesus on the body. That is being demonstrated today. The body of Christ is doing the direct opposite of the instructions of Jesus. And you see, if you can do the direct opposite, you will have money. I'm telling you the truth. If today I say I'm coming here to pray against enemies, finishing the witches in your father's house, if that is the title of today's message, I'm telling you we will have a final termination of sorcery in your father's house. Or killing every witch finally. Bringing them to a terminal end. Everybody will be here. He said today, my finish on finally. He said, let fire settle the matter. Am I talking? Enough of argument. Let fire. You see, that is what we do a whole lot in the body of Christ today. But we see Jesus having a different life. In Matthew chapter number 5, Jesus began to speak from verse 43. Jesus said, You have heard it said that you love your enemy, you love your neighbors, and you hate your enemies. He said, but this I say unto you. This I say unto you. He said, love your enemies. bless those that curse you. He said, do good unto those that hate you, and pray for those that despitefully use you and persecute you. He said, by so doing, you will be the sons or the children of your father. For your father releases his rain upon the just and the unjust, and causes his son to shine on the righteous and the unrighteous. Jesus said, love your enemies. Do good unto those that hate you. He said, bless those that curse you. And pray for those that despitefully use you and persecute you. You know what Jesus is talking about? There is a new law I am giving unto you right now, which is the law of love. If you ever want to see victory in your life, Jesus said, let your prayers be directly in this regard. Let it be directly against the injunctions you've always heard. Many Christians are still living in the Old Testament, expecting the New Testament blessing to rest on us. Now, please understand, there are times when we have to pronounce judgment in the spirit on people. Yes, I've done that severally, and a lot of them have died. You understand what I'm talking about? I've done that severally. Now, that is by the spirit. But you see, don't make a spiritual instruction, which is for the moment, don't make it the doctrine. And make the doctrine the spiritual instruction. I don't know if somebody understands what I'm talking about. The basic doctrine for the church to run on is bless those that curse you. Am I talking to somebody here? Bless those that what? That curse you. That's the basic doctrine. But there is a total change right now, as we can see. Oh yeah, a total change. Jesus was praying. In Luke chapter number 23 and verse 34, he was bleeding, remember, at this time. And those that crucified him were mocking him at this time. And it was a shameful death. Oh, the Bible says he despised the shame. It was a shameful death. Very shameful death. He disregarded the shame. And then, as they were mocking him, Jesus looked at it. He knew that this was a big sin. This is what he committed. Just like the sin of Judas. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they need not what they are doing. Luke 23 verse 34. Father, forgive them, for they knew not what they are doing. See, ladies and gentlemen, we need to get to this point in Christianity where we begin to realize that, look, you are praying to God to answer you. How will God answer you? You are praying to God to answer, and God has told you this is the way to provoke my answer. And you are saying, no, God, leave that one you said. This is the way I want to take to obtain an answer from you. That's the reason why people pray and they are frustrated. God is my witness. The churches that made this thing doctrinal, I have a lot of, even pastors, so many pastors have come from there to see me personally. I never saw victory on any side of their life with all the fall down die they are doing. A woman came out of there, that had serpent rolling on his physical. She didn't tell me. I said, Mama, I can see the python I saw was a python, big one, and was rolling all over her like this. I can see a big python all over you. She said, yes. He said, that was the reason actually why I came. I told somebody, and they said, look, I can refer this pastor to you. He said, I see that snake. That snake goes all over my... He said, if she feels it, if she physically feels the movement of the snake. I said, Mama, I'm going to cast the snake out now. And she said, she's a pastor in Fordham and I. Lay hands on now, not the power of the Holy Ghost. Snake, out! And the snake left. The woman didn't believe when I said, Otilo. She went, she came back. He said, Pastor, Kogwama. She came back with an offering. Am I talking to somebody? And she started bringing people. Now, you see, she had been doing this thing, casting the thing out further, and that the thing didn't go. He said, Mama, it won't go. One MD came to see me of a bank. He said, Pastor, we've been fasting and praying. And he said, and all of us that are praying, he said, we looked at ourselves and we saw defeat in all our lives. The man said it himself. He's a senior member of the same church. He said, we saw defeat in all our lives. Defeat, parapata. I said, there's no way you will see victory in your life doing exactly what Jesus cannot confirm. He only confirms his word. We've gone through that through scriptures. Am I right? Mark chapter 16, the Bible says, and there they were. The Bible says, and they went forth preaching, and the Lord walking with them, confirming his word with signs and wonders. So how can you be telling him to confirm what is not his word? I'm telling somebody here, whatever is not God's word in your life, I erase them from your destiny. Everything that is afflicting you is cursed in the name of Jesus. It's one thing to pronounce judgment on circumstances, poverty, sickness, all of that. But when it comes to human beings, be very careful. Make sure it is by the Spirit before you say it. Make sure it is what? It's by the Spirit. Don't just open your mouth and begin and form a doctrine. Every day you want to pray now. Every week in this building, fall down and die. Break their witchcraft power and say, Father, please give them chance to repent. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Break their power, as in we take authority over the demons and then cast it. Break their powers over your life. Further and down, Jesus won't confirm it. So it's needless wasting your time. It's needless what? Wasting your time. Except it tells you now, pronounce judgment on the witches in this building. Then pronounce. And all of them will die. But if he has not told you, ladies and gentlemen, let's check out on our prayer life. The Bible said the early apostles, it's the same way they followed. There was a man by the name Stephen. We all knew about the story. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 7 and verse 60, they were stoning Stephen. In fact, verse 59, the Bible says, as they were stoning him, Stephen cried out with a loud voice. Verse 59, Acts chapter 7. He said, Father, Lord Jesus, take my spirit. Receive my spirit. And verse 60, the Bible says, and he cried out with a loud voice, saying, Father, do not lay this sin to their charge. He was already receiving the pain. Can you imagine a big stone or stone that can kill? Do you understand? On somebody's body, go back, all over him. Blood coming out, bruises everywhere. And then it is inside that pain that you remember that this is the best time to forgive. Omo, going through hurt is not sufficient. Let his word prevail. Let his word. And you know one thing? The moment you do that, you see, there is a greater judgment you are actually pronouncing on. Don't think that by praying for them, you are sparing them. No. The Bible says, let me tell you this. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. The Bible says, glory be to God. Glory be to God. The Bible says, when your enemy is hungry, give him food. He said, when he needs this, do this. When he needs that, he said, be a blessing to them. He said, by so doing, you are actually heaping coals of fire on their head. That is the best time to release fire on their head. By blessing them, you are releasing what? By praying for them, you are releasing what? And when fire comes on their head, ladies and gentlemen, fire can produce two levels of result. Number one is that fire can refine and fire can reduce to ashes. It can either refine or reduce to what? So when you are praying for them, those that need zigbala out of them, one rigbalagba. You will burn them. You will roast them by praying for them. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Imagine if Stephen had prayed that, Father, all these people that laid this stone on me, kill them one by one before 6 p.m. tonight. If Paul the apostle had died, imagine what the New Testament would have been without Paul. Remember, they laid their clothes at Paul's feet. And Paul was consenting to the idea, kill him, stole him, yes, yeah, no. You see, the other side of his head, yeah, that plant is spared, yeah, bruised, yes, tiger, yes, oh, yeah, yes, yeah, the other side, yes, oh, yes, you are doing well, yes, oh, yeah. Paul was commanding them to finish him. You know, when Paul was talking to a man of God, he said the greatest motivation of his life to go through all the afflictions of his life was the death of Stephen. He said this man was dying and his face was radiant and he was still even praying for them. Paul said, no matter what he went through in affliction, he said, anytime he remembered that thing, he said, Stephen's life was a seed that was sown for his own salvation. So if Stephen had prayed and released fire, that fire refined Paul. I'm telling you, Father, finish Boko Haram. Many of them will become apostles of the last days. Oh, many ISIS guys. I'm telling you the truth, ladies and gentlemen. They will take Jesus to the hands of the heart. Pray for them. Those that need total refining, the fire will do what? The fire also has another aspect. I should talk about it. Don't let us pretend. Say, Pastor, talk about it. I should talk about it. In 1 Kings chapter 1, or 2 Kings chapter 1, some people came to a prophet called Elijah. Man of God, come on! He said, be a servant of God. May fire from heaven turn you to suya now. The Bible said, the captain, verse 10, and his 50, making 51 people. And the second person came, very foolish. You saw ashes on ground, and you still repeated it. Fire can refine, and fire can reduce to ashes. But I pray, as you pray for them, the love of God into the kingdom. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So let's do good unto them doctrinally. Let's be a blessing. Who could see this in the ministry of Jesus? The fact that you're going through pains doesn't mean you should not be a blessing to your enemies. If they are hungry, give them food. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 21, Romans 12, 21, he says, be ye not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. And in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, the Bible says, do not render evil for evil, railing for railing, but rather blessings. Don't repay evil for evil. Am I talking to somebody here? There was a man of God that went to lock up the tie of another man of God. True life story. He locked up his tie. He said, you are the reason why I failed the ministry. Because the other man of God came, brought his church, and his church was growing, and his own church became depopulated. So he went to lock up the tie of this other man and said, you are the reason why I failed the ministry. That one said, I felt like punching him. He said, but I just looked at him and I told him, you know what, if you know how many hours I stayed on the cold floor praying for you. That guy looked at him. He repented and he started apologizing. The two of them had some dinner together and their fellowship continued. He said, at times you feel so hot that you feel like punching the person. A woman, you know, a particular man of God went on the radio and was preaching about a woman preacher. Preached so badly about this woman preacher. You know what the woman preacher did? She didn't do anything. She just collected offering. He heard that man of God was in serious financial problem. Collected offering and sent it to him to meet. When the man collected it, the thing broke his heart. He called the woman preacher to come and preach in his church. Somebody went from this church and started saying rubbish about me and all that. You know what I did? I just sent for him and his wife. How are you? Fine. How's everything? What about this that you are doing? What about that? Well, I became a blessing to them. And I got a check, signed it out, and I gave it to them. Paid it and all that into their account and all that. The man flew up from his chair. He looked at me. He was in his total state of bewilderment. Since that day, his mouth was shut. When you be a blessing to them, instead of saying, Father, fire, be a blessing. You will see that's the best way to put padlock in their mouth. God bless you in Jesus' name. What else do we see about the prayer life of Jesus? Thank you, Lord Jesus. There was rugged determination. That is point number three today. We are on point number six now. Am I right? Rugged determination for prayers in the prayer life of Jesus. Rugged what? You see, a lot of times, we don't understand satanic strategies of operations. If you are not ruggedly determined to pray, the devil is going to distract you out of prayers. One thing the devil fears is prayer. If you give me 10 preachers who can preach so well, and only give me one who may not be able to preach so well, but can pray so well, the devil fears that one. The other 10 that cannot pray, the devil doesn't fear them. See, so many preachers are preaching, driving everything with the brilliance of authority. You don't need to be born again before you have brilliance of authority. It's a talent. Have you not seen unbelievers with that kind of talent? Do you understand? It's a talent. So they can talk and everybody. Look at brother Apollo. But Apollo can talk. The Bible says he was eloquent in speech. Am I right? But everywhere he went, na contention. He pastored the Corinthian church, na contention there. Paul said, you say you are of Apollo. You are this. He said, are you not Cana? Have you forgotten? Everywhere he went, na wahala. Apollo always had unfinished business everywhere he went. Are you catching what I'm talking about? But brother Paul, the Bible says his speeches are bad and his appearance amounted to nothing. But that man had a prayer life. He said, I speak in tongues more than ye all. To a whole church? that man was a prayer mantis. Am I talking to somebody here? Now tell me, who did the devil fear more between Paul and Apollos? Paul was a danger to the kingdom of darkness. He wrecked hell during his lively ministry. His terrestrial ministry. Do you know what I'm talking about? He didn't have oratory, but he had a prayer life. And see, the prayer Paul prayed on all his letters in prison, you see, that's what made all his letters to still be today. His letters were not lost. So many other people wrote letters that were lost. Am I talking to somebody here? I pray for someone today by the fire of the Holy Spirit. As you are leaving this place, all enemies will see you are wrong. Please mark my words. God is even telling me that he's going to confirm that word right now. That your boss that said he won't let you go will see you are wrong this time around. The witches in your family will see you and they will run this time around. Anytime your name is mentioned, they will fall on their knees. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? Therefore, the devil, knowing that the danger you can really pose to his kingdom is in prayers, he's going to fight and resist your prayer life. He will give you so much assignment that you won't remember to pray. The time you're supposed to pray is the time your boss will say, come and do this, come and do that, come and do this, come and do that. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, that's the time the children will remember to cry. You don't understand? If anything the devil fears in any life is to be mentioned, it is prayers. It is what? Prayers. I'm telling you, he fears it so much. So it takes a rugged determination to pray. Now, in Matthew chapter number 14, let's see something here. In Matthew chapter number 14, the Bible said from verse 13, you know, Jesus heard that John the Baptist had died and he was buried by his disciples and all that. That is verse 12. Now, verse 13, Jesus hearing this, he withdrew into a private place. What did he withdraw there to do? To go and pray. He withdrew. He left the multitude and went to a corner in the wilderness. He just withdrew there into the wilderness, the scripture said, to a private place. To go and pray, to go and talk with the Father. When he heard the news, there are some news that can hit you and the next thing that comes to you is to start crying. The first thing is not to cry. You can see it here. When any news came to Jesus, his cousin just died. Remember, Jesus would have been moved by his death. Remember, Jesus, knowing that this is significant to his ministry, because this was one man that also introduced him to ministry. The Bible said he went to pray straight. He withdrew straight. Having heard the news. If you hear any news henceforth, the first thing is not to start crying. I've seen people that they lost their job. The next thing, they took their phone. Pastor, how are you? He said, fine. This sister that got a job that came to share a testimony here, can you remember? That lost her job. And she called me. She went to a toilet and called me. And I said, God said, they'll give you your job back in the oil company. Can you remember? A friend also lost her job and called me. And the same word came again. We prayed and God said, tell her, I've answered you. I'm returning back the job. The friend also has gotten her job back. And others are seriously losing their job. And I've seen that happen a number of times. Do you understand what I'm talking about? The moment a bad news comes, the first thing is to connect with heaven first. Jesus withdrew to the wilderness. And the moment he withdrew, the Bible said the people came on barefoot. On their foot to come and see him. And when they saw him, you must give us food. You must treat us well. Jesus, the Bible says he had compassion on them. He came out of his closet and started ministering to them. And after he finished ministering, multiplied food and all that, the Bible said he constrained his disciples, verse 22, to enter into the boat and so that they can leave. And verse 23, you see, he also dismissed the people, verses 21, 22. And then verse 23, the Bible said, and he went up to a high mountain, straight, and continued praying. Now, he was there to pray. Distraction. Can you be praying when about 10,000 people are standing in front of you, like looking at you? I say, Baba, Elebo. You yourself, you will know that it doesn't work anymore. You have to come out. Pastor Adeboye was talking one day. He said, when his children were young, he said, before he got experience, the children will come. Adeboye said, the last born. I said, Daddy, I want biscuits. He said, look, are you the devil? The devil wants to use against me. He will smite the boy. Get out of here. Pastor Adeboye said, he never knew when before he had experience. He said, that will be the end of the prayer. Because the boy will not continue what? Crying. At the end of the day, he cannot pray very. He will get more angry with the boy. And the boy will not understand. And the boy will continue crying. And it messes up his prayer life. He said, when he now grew up in experience, he learned that when the boy said, I need cookies, he said he will stand up from his knees. He will go to where the cookies, he will give him. And he said, thank you, daddy. Then he will go back to continue his prayer. So, we want to start praying and your son is saying, mommy, food, food. After you go for food, don't take that food as a bailout from prayer. Go back.
We believe you have been blessed by this message. For more information, prayers, and counseling, you can reach us on the following numbers: 080-33-706-938 and 080-28-28-1839, or visit our website at www.dgccinternational.org and connect with us on our social media platforms: facebook.com/DGCCINTL, Instagram at DGCCINTL. On YouTube, search Divine Glory Christian Church. Our Twitter handle is at DGCCINTL. Stay blessed.